So, first of all, I will introduce myself a little bit. So I come from geophysics. I studied geophysics at the University of Vienna, and I started 25 years or maybe 27 years now ago to work at the Geological Survey in Austria. The first times of my life, I was working for airborne geophysics, did data processing and interpretation. Then I moved on to geoelectrics, and I was responsible for several projects in mineral exploration, groundwater research, and landslide hazard mitigation. Also, I worked some years in volcanism, something that does not exist in Austria, but we were working in Italy. We did also several projects outside of Austria. We have a groundwater project in Mexico. We have landslide project in Nepal, and we have very good cooperation also with South Korea that works very well. We have mineral exploration project in Suriname, and I was in Africa. So we, as a geological survey of, we mainly work in Austria, but we also have an international perspective that we also look outside of Austria in frame of cooperation and to apply things that we do in Austria to other countries. On the other hand, to establish cooperation that we can use things that we develop in cooperations also for the research and development in Austria. And finally, so I was responsible for many research projects in geophysics, geophysical interpretation, and then in 2015, I was the head of the division of applied geoscience in for the Geological Survey in Austria. That means I'm now responsible for more than 65 people working in the area of geochemistry, natural hazard mitigation, geothermics and groundwater, landslides, and not to forget, I think that's it. There's so many departments now. And since my director is now going to retire and this position will not be refilled in the near future, I will also be director for the next, let's say, at least 2 years, and then we will see how this will continue. This is because at the moment, first of all, in my talk, I will give you a short overview of the structure of the Geological Survey and the change we are undergoing at the moment. Then I will introduce you to some methodologies, geoelectrics and geoelectrical monitoring. And finally, I will focus on the cooperation or possible subjects of cooperation in the near future. So here you see the structure of the Geological Survey. I'm responsible especially for the division of applied geoscience. It's not easy to read, but yes, we have several departments down here, but since the structure of departments, if you work in several application projects, it's very straight and tight. So we have introduced a matrix system upon the structure of the department. So we have now programs where people from all of the departments are contributing to these programs. So it's a very open structure now. So we have the program of raw materials, groundwater, geothermal energy and geomonitoring and geohazards, and a horizontal work program that is due to development of measurement devices and measurement technology. In the middle, we have here the managing team, which I am also part of. Then we have the data center and we have the communication center. Communication center is something that is being established in near future, so we don't have this at the moment. But I also think it's very important not just to talk with the people on a scientific level, because you know, a geological survey, we are not working as a scientist only, but we are delivering a service to the open public and to the people. So as a geological survey, we need to provide something that can be used by society. And therefore, it's also very important to communicate with the people. And that will be one of the pillars that we are going to establish in the near future here. And then we have the division of geological mapping. This is the they are producing the basic maps of Austria. So it's the 1 to 25,000 scale. Then it's one program that collects all the information that is available on the archives and puts this to some maps that are not proven in the field. So we have some areas that are not covered by maps, but a lot of information available. So we are producing some preliminary maps. These are called geofast maps. So this is a coverage of an area, but it's not proven finally in the field. But it's something also very important in Austria. Then there's a smaller program, standards, standardization in, you know, Austria has a very difficult geology and you have many different units, and since geologists are very special people, they go out and everyone has special names for different units. So it's very important to put all these names together, that if you communicate with others, you know what you are speaking about. So you need to establish a common language. And then we have the overview maps, 1 to 200,000 scale, 1 to 500,000 scale of Austria. Of course, we have some international projects, and yeah. This is a more detailed structure of the Division of Applied Geoscience. It's very difficult to be read, but I will focus just on the geomonitoring later on. So in each of the sections, in each of the programs, we have some special modules. So the basic is data and models. So the core task of a geological survey is to collect high-resolution data of the geological area of Austria. That is not just geology, it's minerals, it's groundwater, it's everything. And then we do research and development, especially in the areas where we need some innovation to create this high quality data. And then on the top level, we have the layer of responsible research and innovation. This is the area where we closely cooperate with stakeholders and the society and the people outside. So the three layers, data and models, doing new research. This is also a layer where we cooperate very closely with universities. And then we have the layer where we cooperate with the stakeholders, the user of the data. And we have several projects where together with the stakeholders, we work on special problems. Now I told you there will be some change in the near future of the geological survey. So the plan of the ministry is now to merge the geological survey with the meteorological survey. This is a big challenge because it's something, in the beginning we thought, okay, something completely different, but thinking more and more in depth, we see a lot of advantages in this cooperation. So the main topic also in Austria is, of course, climate change, and the European community wants to be CO2 neutral in the year 2050. And that's a big goal for all Europe. So in this kind of view, a cooperation between meteorology and geology is a very challenging, but maybe very innovative path to go forward. And it's not very usual that something like this is established, especially in Europe. I think I know of no institution that combines meteorology with geology and geophysics. Just by chance, it's very funny that meteorology, they have also a geophysical department, and here there's also a geophysical department doing different kinds of work. Here is earthquake, and on the other side, there's mainly applied geophysics. So it will also in geophysics, it will a big step forward. So we will now establish a department with more than 50 people just working in geophysics. It's quite a lot of, for Europe, it's quite a big department. Yes, and we have many topics that in frame of climate change need a kind of cooperation with the meteorologists. Just to think about alternative energy. So we have here wind, solar, and we have geothermal here. So what we'll produce in future is potential maps of alternative energies. When you think of groundwater, of course, groundwater recharge is changing with climate change. So we will also have a program devoted to calculate, to estimate the change of the groundwater recharge due to climate change. Of course, natural hazards is a big topic that is on the top that needs to be treated on both sides. So we'll have also an emergency task force in case some hazards are happening, flooding or landslides, that they work together, go out and supply the stakeholders with data. And there's several other topics where it makes some sense that the meteorologists and geologists work together. On the other hand, what is very positive for us as geophysicists, they have a very big data center, the meteorologists, and especially for remote sensing and SAR, DINSA and PSA measurements, we need big computers, and so we will establish a common data center for both areas, and we will have a communication center where we will also employ some social scientists to establish some way to talk with the people. So, and very important, on top there will be a unit establishing projects between the Geological Survey and the universities. So in future, the cooperation with universities will be very important. We see it as, yeah, we see the Geological Survey in an intermediate structure between the stakeholders and the universities and other research organizations. It's a public body, and the main task is to provide data and advance research that other people could also use. So there are several institutions in Austria, and we will communicate and cooperate a lot with stakeholders with the task to define the demand the stakeholders have. If you go to the counties and talk with the people, usually they have no connection to research. So what we want to do as a geological survey, talk with the people, ask them, what is really the demand? What do you really need outside? What do you need to make life easier, and what are the problems? And then we define the research demands, and we provide them data, and they also send data to us. So we will construct a kind of data center in the middle. And in this case, I'm speaking also of this monitoring center I'm talking about. This is a structure of the principal setup of the Geological Survey, but as a first step, we are now going to install this monitoring center in Austria. So the stakeholders, they will tell us what to monitor. The stakeholders will receive our monitoring data, but we will ask them what are the major points that needs to be monitored, and we are establishing this monitoring for them, and the data is sent to Austria. On the other side, there are the universities and other research organizations. We define the demand for research together with the stakeholders, and then we get money from the ministry to do research projects together with the universities. So we will define the topics of the research work. There will be special calls, and universities together with departments from the Geological Survey can submit proposals which are evaluated outside of the survey, and then special groups will get special projects with a separation of 50-50 between university staff and Geological Survey staff. Well, I think this will be a very straightforward methodology to advance research that cannot be done just in the Geological Survey, but we need also to focus the capacities of the universities. And this plan will be combined with the working plan for the universities. They have a 3-year working plan from the ministry, and this will be written down, this cooperation, also in the working plan from the universities. Yeah, and there will be a kind of disaster response task force that we go out. It's a combination, a cooperation also with the military services and other institutions. In case a disaster will happen, we have people inside, they collect all the data in this area, put them into a certain emergency web space, and supply this information to the stakeholders, to the decision makers. On the other hand, we will have a group going out to the field, establishing an inclinometer, kind of monitoring, whatever, and providing this data in the same platform to the stakeholders there. So it will not be a group that helps the people directly, but gives help and advice to the stakeholders and the decision makers in case of an emergency, because one of the problems is that once something happens, you are lacking of data. You need to have enough data as soon as possible after a disaster. And with this group, we want to close this gap to provide data as soon as possible after the disaster. That will help for sure. On the other side, if you see such a structure, we have a geological survey in all of the countries in Europe, and the plan is to set up such a structure in all of the countries, and then to connect our EuroGeoService, the Organization of Geological Service of Europe. And I heard that something like that exists also now in Asia and is going to build up soon. And then we will have a common platform where all this information is supplied also to the European Commission. And this is also the chance that geological information of all Europe is going back to universities for research. So in future, universities in Europe will have access to geological data from all of Europe. That's the plan. That's not established so far. And you know, in a geological service, there are more than 40 countries. It's a big challenge, but we will go this step forward. Well, this was just some words about the structure to give you an impression what is going on the structural perspective in Europe at the moment and in Austria. Now I'm more focusing on landslide investigation in the Geological Survey of Austria. This is the structure that I've showed before, but just taking out the monitoring hazard mitigation section. Geological Survey of Austria is not a big survey. We have just 140 people, so we cannot do everything. So we are focusing on some very special topics. So in the lower level, we are doing integrated 3D models of the subsurface, including airborne geophysics. We are deriving parameter maps of the subsurface. That means we are going to acquire resistivity geology, and then we transform this to a geotechnical model and to parameterize the subsurface layers. On the other hand, we have an event database where we collect all the events of landslides and other hazards in Austria on a daily basis. So we are operating the landslide database for Austria, and we got this duty now from the ministry. So it's just one institution that is doing this in Austria. This is a major success now, because in the past there were many different landslide databases and it was impossible to get an overview, but just recently we managed to combine this in one place. And then in the research section, we are building up this Austrian landslide monitoring network. So we are now also responsible on landslide monitoring in Austria. We are cooperating with the Torrent and Avalanche Control. This is an institution that is responsible for all these events and remediation of these events, but they are not responsible for research. So what we do is, in case something happens, we advise them what they could install. They will do the installation together with us of monitoring systems, and then we are operating them. And when they have finished their projects that last for 3 or 5 years after remediation, the system is passed over to us, and we will maintain the system after the finalization of their projects. Because we think it is very important, even after a disaster, to continue with the monitoring of such a system. Okay, in principle, in case of an investigation, we have certain steps that we apply. First of all, we also have a group doing remote sensing, so we analyze a big area with remote sensing, mainly PSR data, to find out which are the areas that are most susceptible to sliding. Of course, this procedure is not only applicable to landslide, but also to groundwater research and mineral exploration, so it's basically the same for all areas. And we have an event database, and we correlate these results, of course, also with the event database. And what we do is a kind of ground motion service for Austria on a yearly basis, that we provide some PSR differential maps every year to see what is going on the Austrian territory. And then if there are some focus areas, we go inside, and then we can, for example, do airborne geophysics from the helicopter with several methodologies, and this gives an overview over the smaller area, and mainly to get an overview on the subsurface, what is really happening there. We investigate in more detail, applying geoelectrics in the next step and ground mapping. And based on the geoelectrics, we will select several drilling positions. Of course, we apply drilling and borehole geophysics to calibrate the geoelectrical results. That is a very important step. If you apply geoelectrics, always you have some information also on the basic data of geoelectrics. But if you do a calibration, the information is much more accurate. And then, once we know the principal structure of the subsurface, we can put some monitoring systems there, especially to investigate the principal processes that are going on in the subsurface. Because find out, usually, of course, there's a correlation between rainfall and triggering of a landslide. But this is not a direct correlation. Sometimes if some rain falls, the landslide is triggered, sometimes not. So we need to have more information what processes really trigger the landslide. And that's something that we can investigate with geoelectrical monitoring. And once we know about the processes, maybe it's easier to decide which monitoring systems are sufficient for a landslide. Maybe a piezometer is sufficient, but if it's put on the correct side. Then we do also geotechnical models and supervise the remediation with online monitoring, because it's also important to see if remediation is done, if it's successful, if something is changing in the subsurface, or if the original processes are still going on. So there are a lot of theoretical points, but now we are moving to the practical aspects. Some key goals that we have, we need reliable results. There are so many results available, but we need to focus on high quality data, reliable data, and of course also long-term data series. Problem with university people and PhDs always that they're working for 3 years. In the first year they install the system, second year maybe the system runs, and then they have 1 or 2 years of data. So therefore, we will overtake the monitoring for them and supply the data to the research students, that they have really long-term, high-quality data sets. That is something that is my point of view. If we would like to advance with research, very important. And one thing is also very interesting. All the data I take, it's not my personal treasure. The data needs to be made available to everyone. And we are taking so many data, and it's so expensive, and it's sometimes really a lot of data is lost. So one of the focus points we are now applying in Austria is it's very hard for the scientists. They don't like this. It's my data and I don't give it away. So, but it's really, if we want to go forward, we need to share data. And the only thing to communicate, and that's also why I'm also here, is we need to share experience, we need to share data, we need to share equipment, we need to share everything. So in geophysics, the community is quite small, but if all the small groups work isolated, it will not work to cooperate. But if we work together, we will. There are big challenges, and geophysics is one methodology that is really very important to solve these big challenges that we have in society. So there's a demand that we really work together. So just a small excursion to airborne geophysics. We also have an air helicopter with electromagnetic system, a gamma ray system, and a magnetic system. It's a methodology that is very efficient for different kind of work, for groundwater mineral exploration, but also for landslides. Here you see a very nice picture from a landslide in Austria. This is a picture of the resistivity measured by the helicopter, and you very clearly see the area of the landslide determined here. Of course, the landslide in this case has a very low resistivity, it's a clay landslide. And in many cases in Austria, we first apply airborne geophysics to determine the area that is sliding. Based on the resistivity, in many cases, not all cases, you can see it very clearly here. And also, for example, here you can see saline intrusion in Mexico, in Yucatan. They have a karst cave system, and we tried to map the karst caves, which are filled with saline water from the helicopter. You can very clearly see here the karstic caves, and some of these caves were not known before this survey. In the next picture, you see the maps of the caves that are mapped by cave divers. So especially in this area, they were not known, and this is in Yucatan, and just last beginning of last year, the drivers took this map and closed the connections here. So now this is the world's largest underwater cave structure that exists, because they used the electromagnetic maps to find a connection here in between, they finally found. And here you can also see a very clear map of the freshwater layer on top of the saline water floating in the karst area and the saltwater infiltration here from the sea. So also need to keep in mind that the methodologies I'm talking about, they are just cannot be used for landslide monitoring, they can be used for many different purposes. Also groundwater exploration, mineral exploration, monitoring of geotechnical applications. So it's something that is you can apply in a kind of universal way. Now I'm focused just on landslide in the next pictures, but keep in mind it's something that you can use for many other areas. In 1999, there was a big landslide in Austria. Many houses were destroyed, and it was the case where we first applied geoelectrics for landslide investigation. And because the tornado and avalanche control, they called us in because they made some seismics and they couldn't see anything. Because, of course, if you have a landslide, it's moving, you cannot have any layers inside. So they had the idea maybe geoelectrics could be a good methodology. And this is one example from a landslide, and we have also some inclinometric data here. So you see, for some constant data, then it's a little bit moving here, and you have a shift, a sliding plane here. So we have two sliding planes here and here. And you see, in a resistivity structure, you very well can determine the different areas of the landslide. And this is one example, but we have measured on 50, 60 landslides now. But in many cases, it was very clearly that we could determine sliding plane and internal structures of landslide much better than with seismics. And of course, geoelectrics is much quicker and cost effective than seismics. So it was very clear that here you have a very tight correlation of the inclinometric data. Here you have a clay part that is moving very quickly on the top surface. Then we have some more gravel structure that is sliding very smoothly on top of another clay layer here. In many cases, we found structures like that quickly moving part and a slowly moving part below. Yeah, at that time, there were no commercially available instrumentations that could measure, monitoring in geoelectrics, so we had the idea to start the development on our own. So it took several years till 2006 when the first system was ready, and we have now our GeoMon system. It was also a big challenging coincidence, because at the same time, as you see here, there's a fuel cell, so we need to have a power supply outside. So before, just with solar power, you don't have enough power, so you need also some fuel cells, and these were just commercially available around 2006 in Austria. So now we have a combination of solar and fuel cell power, and you can put out the system and it autonomously works for 1 year, half a year till 1 year, without any maintenance. So you need not go there and refuel for at least half a year. And the data is sent automatically to our office in Vienna. Well, the difference to other systems is that this is automatic. It sends the data via GSM to our office, and we measure each single measurement is sampled for almost 3,000, 4,000 times. So we measure the raw signal, and we save the raw signal, and we apply some special quality assessment on the raw signal. So together with the resistivity value, for each resistivity value, we have 8 quality indications. And the quality indications, they are also used in the inversion. So that's something that is not commercially available. Of course, companies, they don't really need this, but this is a measurement system that is just for research. But we can really advance data quality when we use also the data quality for inversion. So for inversion, we don't just use the resistivity, apparent resistivity, we use also 8 quality parameters. And the inversion process is done together with the scientists from KIGAM in South Korea. They did the inversion process with us, and it's a very user demand inversion that is done just for the GeoMon system. So this was also very valuable cooperation that is still going on now. Yeah, and what we also did is lightning protection, a special unit for lightning protection for each of the incoming channels, especially in Austria in the high mountains, it's a big challenge. Of course, if the system is hit by a direct stroke, yeah, it's done. Here again, you see the system. And very important is the combination always for calibration with other sensors. And here we cooperate with a company from Italy. They are producing automatic inclinometers. You then can put them in the subsurface. You don't need really a helicopter. You can use an engine like this or just a caterpillar, put it inside. It has segments of just 1 meter, and it measures the ground motion with an accuracy of 0.3 millimeters. So it's very high accuracy. And the big advantage is that you can derive information on the ongoing processes several times before you really see something on the surface. So it's high resolution, and the system can stay inside for a very long time, even till a movement in the subsurface of 1 meter. So recently we had a system that showed a movement of more than 1 meter. It was not damaged, and we still could put out the system and repair it. So it was quite easy. And with a normal manual inclinometer, you put the pipe in and you can measure maybe till 1, 2, 3 centimeters, but this system can stay inside for until 1 meter or even 2 meters if you want to lose the system. So of course it's not the cheapest one, but it produces high data quality, and that's something that is really important. If you don't have high data quality, the conclusions you derive, they are sometimes really not so valuable. So it's better to focus on good equipment. The other side, we also had some monitoring system with like a very cheap camera that is put to the field. And if the movement of a landslide is very quick, you can also derive very nice movement profiles here, digitized by a student from a landslide. I will show you the video afterwards. So you can put the camera outside for 3, 4, 5 years. And it maps the movement if it's quick. If it's very slow, you have to use an inclinometer, but if it's very quick, you can use, quick means a meter per month. You can use also a simple camera with a time-lapse recording, and you can measure also the speed with high accuracy. That's sufficient for a quick moving landslide. So this is one example from a famous landslide in Austria. It was going down here in 2007 in Austria, and a lot of buildings were endangered here. We did some monitoring, and here you see the inclinometer that was put inside the landslide. In this case with a helicopter, because there was a TV team outside and it's much more prominent to do it with a helicopter, but of course it's not necessary to use a helicopter. You can just use a caterpillar to put it inside. But with a helicopter it's very quick, so the installation of the inclinometer took just 5 minutes with the helicopter. And for us, the helicopter from the army is for free because we have a close cooperation with the army on a scientific basis. And here you can see the high resolution data. Here you see displacement in millimeters, and you can see that very small changes in the behavior of the landslides could be mapped very easily, which could not be seen in this case on the surface. So you can investigate what is going on in the subsurface sometime before really an event is happening. That gives you a big advantage to design a kind of pre-alarm system and early warning system. And 7 years after we recovered the system, maximum displacement was close to 1 meter, but we still could recover the system. We put it out and it was just one segment was repaired. This was a big success also for this company. Yeah, now I focus on 1, 2, and 3 case studies for monitoring. This is a very small landslide. It was a landslide close to this building. It was a young family building a house, and soon after this, there were some cracks, and they put all the money in the house, and they were very unhappy that the whole house was moving afterwards. So they asked us for some help, and since we had, you see, there were some cracks, and they were really frightened that the whole house could be destroyed. Here is the parking place of the house. So we did our geoelectrical research also there. You see here, in red, we have the inclinometric results. You see here, very nice for us, displacement event of maybe, the scale is here, maybe 3 centimeters. I will show you the geoelectrical result soon afterwards. You see, in combination with the rainfall, this event was very strong, and was, in principle, it was the rainfall that triggered this event. But we had also other events that triggered not a rainfall. But in this case, turned out it was the pre-wettening of the subsurface that finally triggered this case study. What you can see here is the inversion results with the software we developed together with the Korean guys. You see the differences in geoelectric. So blue means more water, so it's quite easy understanding. If the picture turns blue, then it's more water. And we have a basic measurement here, and the difference is to the red ones. So here, we can hardly see any changes. Also now, we don't see changes, but then the first rainfall starts. We see some infiltration now. Here, a little bit of infiltration, but the landslide is so far not triggered, but then once the rainfall penetrates down till the sliding plane here, the landslide starts also to move, red curve here. And finally, so in the major triggering phase, you have the wettening, the full saturation in the subsurface here. And soon after, when the landslide movement comes down, also the water content goes back. Well, it's a very nice example how you could monitor the infiltration of the water in the subsurface and the triggering of the landslide together with the infiltration. Here you see the resistivity picture. It's a high resistivity in this area. That means we have some sand or gravel in the clay layer, and the water is captured inside here and here. And here you see the differences exactly in this area. Water is infiltrating here, and the landslide is starting to move. And this is also a very nice example from Italy. It's Panaschino, where we also did some monitoring. This is a crystalline rock, and an alluvial layer on top of the crystalline rock is moving on the basement. So again, here you see the red line is the inclinometric data. And you see one big rainfall event that triggered a landslide, but another rainfall event that did not trigger the landslide. And the question was why, and we still don't know why, but we know that there are different processes going on in the subsurface. So again, we see the inversion results for the first case. Here you have time 1, 2, 3, 4, and this is the difference between 0 measurement and time 1. You see hardly any infiltration. Then again, you see the infiltration. Again, more infiltration. The infiltration reaches the sliding plane, and this is exactly the time when the landslide starts to move. And then we have again full saturation of the subsurface. Again, very nicely see the infiltration of the water in the subsurface causing the triggering of the landslide. And then we come to the second case. You see again, inclinometric measurements did not show any movements. And you see the differences in electric measurements. There was not any infiltration, so all the water was flowing on the subsurface down. So this proved that in this case, where the inclinometric measurement did not show any movement, was not any infiltration down to the slipping plane of the landslide. This is very important information that in this area a landslide is triggered once the water infiltrates down to the slipping plane, and for early warning it could be enough to have just one piezometer for further measurements here. So this was a very important result for this area. Now I come to the final test site. It's area very close to the first area, and we see we have high resistivity, higher resistivity crevice on the top, but then we have a lot of clay downwards. The resistivity values are in a range between 5 to 50 ohm meters. So in general, the resistivity variations are very small. It's a typical picture. Maybe here the crevice, they have higher resistivity, but here we have 15, and it's quite difficult to read. Here we are around 100. So variations here are not very large, and this is one of the profiles with the highest resistivity variation in the subsurface. In some other areas, we hardly have any variation. So we did some monitoring there. Of course, first of all, we did geoelectrics on a 3D way. Then we did borehole geophysics and drillings to calibrate the resistivity values. Then we did probe sampling, geochemical analysis, soil, clay mineral analysis of these parts. And then finally we installed the geoelectrical system. Usually we put the cables to the subsurface and we covered them because people are working on this area, so the best way to install a system is to cover them with earth material. Here you have the solar power and the fuel cell is inside this hut. Then we started with some monitoring. And yes, finally what you can see here in the monitoring is there was not so much effect. It was just, there were some movements, but it was just, of course, rainfall in the upper layers. And yeah, the water penetrated to a certain area. And this is very interesting picture that shows us also the limitation of geoelectrical monitoring, because once you come to some resistivity values that are close to 25, 30, 25, 10 ohm meters, it's the same value as the resistivity of the groundwater in Austria. So once groundwater penetrates towards these structures, you won't see any effect. So this methodology does not work for really high density clay areas. Sometimes you will get results, but if it's very clay, it will not show any differences. It's almost the same value that if it's saturated with water or not saturated with water. The picture is very clear that it came out from many measurements that we did, and we have some test areas where we did monitoring over 7-8 years. In clay areas, it's difficult to find out what is happening. Therefore, of course, what to do? But the challenge here is we should work on IP measurements, because clay, the idea is that if you have a landslide moving and you have some pressure on the clay and you have infiltration of water, resistivity might not change so much, but of course IP values could change. So the big challenge for the future, in my point of view, since we also need a monitoring system for clay areas, is to start developing a monitoring system with using IP for landslide clay areas. And that is also the point where I think that the cooperation could be very valuable. And so far, I think no one really has worked on this topic. Yes, and during the last years, we have also advanced our geoelectrical monitoring systems together with the Koreans. And now, finally, after long more time, our new system is out that also is susceptible of doing the IP monitoring. And it's a very open system. You see it like it's this test version here. You have many different cards and you can add GPS, whatever you want. And you can add here as many electrodes as you want. So it's a very open system, usable for scientists. It's not a commercial system, but it's a system that can be used by scientists to do research work. And it's now finally working after many years of development, working quite well. And the software we have is developed again by our Korean colleagues. They do the data processing and the inversion. You very nicely can see here for each of the measurement, you have the background, you have the decay curve. And yeah, you can do everything with this software. You can define the decay length, you can define the sampling ratio, you can filter the noise, you can do data quality assessment. That is a software that is very open to researchers. Of course, for a company, they cannot use something like this, because you really have to work on the data, you have to assess the data quality, you have to go into details, you do some first measurements, see if you really have a decay curve, because many of these IP instruments that are available on the market, you never see the full decay curve. You see just the integral value or just two windows or three windows. But I always said, okay, IP is something very special. You are measuring very small signals and always you have the noise of the 50 Hertz frequency. It's something where if you want to have good IP signal, and I think most of the publications, I'm not really sure if they have really good IP signals in their work. So what this instrumentation gives you really the chance to see the raw data values, to save all the raw data values and do the assessment of the data quality. And my philosophy is to measure as many as data as possible and then to reduce the data and just use the high quality data. That's better than just saving time. A company needs to save time, but being a scientist and Geological Survey is responsible for high data quality and also checking of data quality, we need to provide high data quality, and that we will receive only if we are measuring the whole decay curve and see if the signal is really decaying or if you have some noise on it. So here with this system, you can also apply digital filtering. It's a lot of work that still can be done on the raw signals. For example, you see some bursts here, there might be some noise. And this is now the basic equipment that we will use for further development of the IP monitoring methodology. So that's something that is really quite new. We have some field results also compared with other systems like the Super Sting system. It's a different software used for the inversion because we use different data configurations also. It cannot be inverted by the res2dinf. But you see in principle the structures are the same. Maybe we have a high resolution here with our system. Looks quite challenging, and we are now in the point that we also can share. So this brings me to the point, where can we cooperate in future? Well, we are open to all kind of technical transfer, exchange of experience, training for monitoring, data processing, maybe also in cooperation with the Korean guys, but also cooperation in distinct monitoring installations. But really, IP monitoring could be the major topic that we can do research in near future, where we actively cooperate and actively do also publications together. So we are a small group working in this area, and I don't know how many people are working here on this topic, but I think it's a challenge. We should put people together, and you have received some good results in IP measurement in the laboratory. This could be, in my point of view, this is a very valuable cooperation that could fit well for the future, and maybe also airborne geophysics in Thailand could be a topic in the future we can talk also about. But based on my talk now, I think I would really like to focus on IP monitoring. At the moment, I don't think that there is any big research group on the world doing something like that, and we could really be one of the top leaders in this area. It's a small area, but for clay landslide, I think there's a demand in research, and we could focus on this work in our cooperation for the near future. And you know, we also have to celebrate something. It's this week, there's the 150-year anniversary of the scientific cooperation between Thailand and Austria. I didn't know about that before. We had a celebration since my director retired last week, was also one from the ministry. And she told me, one of my bosses, that, that's very interesting. We have a long-term cooperation, and you know, there's also now the princess is in Austria and giving a celebration in Austria. And this happens just this weekend. So, you know, there's a long-term cooperation between Austria and Thailand, and this should be re-established in a more closer way. And I think we have a big chance, since this event happens just now, that this we get also some political support for this. Because this is, there's this event on Sunday, next Sunday in Austria. I'm here and I will report to my ministry just after this meeting and tell them what plans we could have. And maybe there's a chance also on the political level that they could discuss this in Vienna during the meeting. So I will at least try. This could be put more value and more, maybe some political impact is also sometimes important, because this might give us some money. That's also important for successful research. Okay, so we are celebrating something, 150 years of friendship between Thailand and Austria, and I hope this is a good challenge. It's a challenge and a good chance to present my work to you here, and I really hope that in the next years we can establish a very active, intensive cooperation. Thank you very much for listening to me. Hope it was a nice talk, and hoping for the future. Thank you very much.